May the words of my mouth and the meditations of each heart be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
I am glad to see you in person. It has been a strange year, a surreal year, and for many people, a devastating year. For most of a year, we were not able to gather for indoor, in-person worship. And yet, all over the church, congregations adapted. We learned new ways to worship, new ways to proclaim the gospel, new ways to serve our neighbors and do ministry. And your 49th year as a congregation was no exception. So thank you for the new ways that you learn to worship together and serve one another pastorally and serve your neighbors beyond the church. You are to be commended for your creativity and your sacrificial service. I cannot say that I'm surprised at your response to the pandemic, for creativity and sacrificial giving have been part of your DNA for a long time. But we would all agree that loving one's neighbor by staying apart from one another is not natural and not who we are created to be. It has been a sacrifice. So 50 years, on January 3rd of 1971, Father Hume Reeves presided over the first official service of what became Good Shepherd Episcopal Mission. The service was held at the Christian Church in downtown Granbury, and it was attended by 15 people, and the first hymn that you sang was Holy, Holy, Holy. The Episcopal Church of the Good Shepherd has been an important part of the spiritual life of Hood County since those early days. Always an active congregation, I want to suggest that you went into another gear in the years leading up to and following the events of 2008 and 2009. You chose to remain with the Episcopal Church, stepped into leadership roles as we reorganized this diocese, and you have never stopped. Many members of Good Shepherd, including the late Norm Snyder and Barb Click, were active in the work of the steering committee. It was called the Steering Committee North Texas Episcopalians. And for the many of you who weren't here back then, that's the body who worked with the presiding bishop's office to call a new provisional bishop and to organize a special convention for reorganizing the diocese. So it's always dangerous to list names because somebody inevitably gets left out, but Leslie Gwynn, John and Zonnie Back, Ian Moore were among those who were untiring in their work to make this convention happen. And Bill McKay and his beloved Carol celebrated yesterday, they were right there as well. Zani is who organized one of our first United Thank Offering in-gatherings in 2009. Since then, members of Good Shepherd have served on diocesan-wide committees such as the Standing Committee and the Constitution and Canons Committee and the Executive Council. You've been deeply involved in various conventions of the diocese and have served as alternates and deputies to General Convention. And your community. You've reached out to your community in a variety of ways, from your many outreach ministries, to Hymn Fest, to this amazing Hood County Christmas for Children event. And in 2013, when a tornado tore through the Rancho Brazos, if I'm saying that right, Rancho Brazos neighborhood, and wiped out so many homes previously built by Habitat for Humanity, you were right there, joining Mission Granbury, not only for that immediate cleanup, but also for the long haul, helping rebuild those homes. And of course, you found a way to build this building. So in December of 2009, thanks to the foresight of leaders like Linda LaMarca and Paula Duckring and Ian Moore and many others, you had a plan for the immediate future. You worshiped at the Wednesday Women's Club until you outgrew it. You found temporary refuge with the good people of Granbury's Seventh-day Adventist Church. And then with that same foresight and leadership, you found a way to build this building. And that's quite a journey in a short period. In the last decade or so, you have been served by the likes of Bruce Coggan, Frank Reeves, and Susie Robertson. And now you are served by your new priest in charge, Doug Travis, and his assistant, Leslie Gwynn. You know Leslie quite well already, but I would like to say a few words about my longtime friend, Doug. I suspect you know already a part of his resume, and that he served congregations in the Diocese of Dallas and Texas, as well as president and dean of the Seminary of the Southwest in Austin. You may know already that he comes from a family of Presbyterian ministers, and that he lived a good part of his youth in the panhandle of Texas. You know he's a good theologian, and that he's drawn to the mystics. And given that like is drawn to like, he likely is one, but he would deny it. What I really want you to know, though, is about one time when I invited Doug to be the presenter and speaker for the Diocesan Clergy Conference in Northwest Texas several years ago. I couldn't find my notes on that event, but I remember some of it. He spoke to the clergy. He spoke about a clergy person who had served a small congregation in a small panhandle town for years. The minister was a pastor not only to his flock, but to his town. He started a number of needed social agencies in the town. He was visible at the big events. And on weekdays, different cars could be seen in the church parking lot outside the minister's office, cars that were parked normally at the big church on Sunday. Some problems could not be taken to the big church pastor. I think we all know this happens in small towns. Well, certainly Doug's story connected with the clergy of Northwest Texas. And the minister, the pastor of whom Doug spoke, was his own father. And then Doug asked, "Do we in our culture somehow suggest that the rector of the big city cardinal parish, or for that matter the bishop, that rector is somehow more successful than the pastor of this small town congregation?" You see, that congregation was near closing. And even the pastor himself was wondering that very thing as he was looking back over his years of service. And then Doug reminded us of the prayer of thanksgiving in the daily office. That prayer where it says, "We give thanks for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all, for your immeasurable love." Immeasurable. In other words, Doug tells us, God does not measure. That is the voice of grace and mercy and love. That is the voice of a very good shepherd. And that is the voice of the good shepherd. The fourth Sunday of Easter is often referenced as Good Shepherd Sunday, as the readings are passages from the good, about the Good Shepherd, and we say the 23rd Psalm, and our opening collect says, O God, whose Son Jesus is the Good Shepherd of your people, grant that when we hear his voice, we may know him who calls us each by name. If we are honest, there are voices that are aligned with the voice of the Good Shepherd, and there are voices that are not aligned. To be clear, no one is perfectly aligned, not even Doug. I do think that one imperfect but good voice belongs to Pope Francis, who makes a contrast between shepherds and what he calls scholars of the law. Pope Francis tells us that the scholars of the law, as presented in the Gospels, represent the principal opposition to Jesus. They challenge him in the name of doctrine. The scholars of the law challenge Jesus when he heals the leper, for example. For the law of Moses stated that lepers had to be excluded from the city, cast out, and declared impure. In addition to the suffering itself, they faced execution, marginalization, and loneliness. The leper was not just a victim of illness, but also felt guilty, as if he were being punished for his sins. The Pope continues, at his own risk and danger, Jesus goes up to the leper and restores him. He heals him. In so doing, he shows us a new horizon, the logic of a God who is love. Jesus touched the leper and brought him back into community like the good shepherd who leaves the flock to save one lost sheep. Jesus goes and heals and integrates the marginalized, the ones outside the city. And in so doing, he shows us the way. The contrast between the scholars of the law and the good shepherd is not a contrast between doctrine and mercy. It's not that there is opposition between doctrine and mercy. As Pope Francis says, let's not forget that mercy is doctrine. Claiming that God shows mercy and calls us to show mercy is a doctrinal statement. The title of the Pope's book, The Name of God is Mercy, is a doctrinal statement. Claiming that if it's not about love, it's not about God, is a doctrinal statement. And we live in a culture, in a cultural context in America in which we hear some bad theology and witness a lack of mercy. And I'm not suggesting that Episcopalians are perfect nor anywhere near perfection. But when we hear the scholars of the law in our day, public Christian leaders, claim that those who suffered from a hurricane or an earthquake or a typhoon or a natural disaster, that they lived in immoral cities and had it coming, the world needs then a strong voice to declare mercy and love. When we hear current day scholars of the law claim that children died in their classrooms because we removed God from school somehow, as if we had the power to do that, and we cannot be surprised that many people think of the church as judgmental and dogmatic and self-righteous. And the world needs someone to proclaim and embody the good news of God's grace, forgiveness, mercy, and love. Your strong voice is needed in this world. Today we celebrate 50 years of a community of faith who strives to embody the presence of the Good Shepherd and strives to proclaim the voice of the Good Shepherd. It has been quite a journey. And this new, beautiful building is more than a destination. It represents a new beginning. It is an outward, visible sign of mercy, grace, love, even immeasurable love. We can look at this glorious Good Shepherd window, designed especially for this location, showing Jesus standing among the Texas bluebonnets with Lake Granbury and Comanche Peak nuclear power plant in the background. Well, the window says something. Probably says many things. It says to me today that Jesus is present. It says Jesus is present. And it says Jesus still speaks. And may we, the people of the Episcopal Church of the Good Shepherd, forever hear and proclaim his voice. In the name of the Holy Trinity, one God in whom we live and move and have our being. Amen.